हेलो एवरीवन, आई एम उर्वी बनर्जी, वर्किंग एज अ नर्सिंग ट्यूटर एट फैकल्टी ऑफ नर्सिंग रामा यूनिवर्सिटी कानपुर। सो टुडे आई एम हियर टू डिस्कस अ डिजीज कंडीशन नेम्ड एंडोकार्डाइटिस। एज द नेम सजेस्ट, द टर्म आईटिस सफिक्स इज एसोसिएटेड विथ एनी काइंड ऑफ इन्फेक्शंस और इन्फ्लामेशंस एंड द टर्म एंडोकार्डाइटिस ओरिजिनेटेड फ्रॉम इट इज अ डिजीज ऑफ द इनर लेयर ऑफ द हार्ट। सो एवरी विसरल ऑर्गन इज हैविंग सम लेयर्स एंड जस्ट लाइक अदर ऑर्गन्स, हार्ट इज हैविंग थ्री लेयर्स एंड द इनर मोस्ट लेयर ऑफ द हार्ट इज नोन एज एंडोकार्डियम। सो दिस डिजीज कंडीशन इज एसोसिएटेड विथ द इनर लाइनिंग ऑफ द हार्ट, दैट इज नोन एज एंडोकार्डाइटिस एंड ऑल्सो समटाइम्स इट इज नोन एज बैक्टेरियल एंडोकार्डाइटिस और इन्फेक्टिव एंडोकार्डाइटिस एट इट इज एज इट इज जेनरेटेड फ्रॉम अ बैक्टेरियल इन्फेक्शन। सो वी विल सी द डेफिनेशन फर्स्ट। एंडोकार्डाइटिस इज एन इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द एंडोकार्डियम। सो इट इज द इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द इनर लाइनिंग ऑफ द हार्ट एंडोकार्डियम। हार्ट वाल्व्स, इनसाइड हार्ट सम वाल्व्स आर देयर लाइक ट्राइकैस्पिड वाल्व, बाइकैस्पिड वाल्व, मिट्रल वाल्व, एओर्टिक वाल्व। सो इट ऑल्सो इन्वॉल्व्स दोज वाल्व्स और अ कार्डियक प्रोस्थेसिस। सो प्रोस्थेसिस मीन्स एनी आर्टिफिशियल डिवाइसेस आर प्लेस इनसाइड द हार्ट, दैट इज नोन एज प्रोस्थेसिस। सो रिजल्टिंग फ्रॉम बैक्टेरियल और फंगल इन्वेजन। इन्वेजन मीन्स एनी फॉरेन बैक्टेरिया और एनी फंगस इज इन्वेडिंग इन टू आवर बॉडी। दिस इज नॉट कॉमन इन आवर बॉडी, इन्वेडिंग फ्रॉम आउटसाइड ऑफ द बॉडी। सो ड्यू टू दैट इन्वेजन, द इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द एंडोमेट्रियम, हार्ट वाल्व एंड कार्डियक प्रोस्थेसिस आर ऑकरिंग, दैट इज नोन एज एंडोकार्डाइटिस। सो इफ यू आर लुकिंग द रिस्क फैक्टर्स, देर आर सर्टन रिस्क फैक्टर्स एसोसिएटेड टू सम कार्डियक कंडीशन, सम नॉन कार्डियक कंडीशंस एज वेल एज सम प्रोसीड्योर रिलेटेड सिचुएशंस। सो व्हाट आर द कार्डियक रिस्क फैक्टर्स हियर? फर्स्ट वन इज कार्डियोमायोपैथी, इट्स ऑल्सो अ मेडिकल कंडीशन रिलेटेड टू द कार्डियोवास्कुलर सिस्टम। सेकेंड वन इज द प्रायर हिस्ट्री। सो इफ अ पेशेंट इज ऑलरेडी affected with endocarditis previously, then he is more open to get the recurring infection in future. Third one is the VSD, ventricular septal defects. So VSD is also a risk causing factor of endocarditis. Then the mitral prolapse. So mitral prolapse is a prolapsing of the mitral valve. Mitral valve is situated in the left side of the heart in between the ventricle and ventricles. So mitral prolapse is also a cause of endocarditis. And then the pacemakers. We have heard that sometimes the heart pumping is not occurring normally. So in that case, sometimes we place a pacemaker inside the heart to maintain the rhythm of that pumping. So sometimes this pacemaker, if we are placing, that can also, due to some malpractice in the medical field, due to some reason, that can also lead to endocarditis. So if we are going for the non-cardiac causes or risk factors, first one is the IV drug abuse. So abuse, the term means we are not practicing that thing properly. So generally in medical field, sometimes it happens that we do not, sometimes due to our lack of attentiveness or anything like that, we generally do not follow all the protocols. So sometimes by mistake, IV drug abuses are happen. We are not using sterile needles or like that. So the bacteria can invade into our body through that. And then nosocomial infection. The term nosocomial means hospital acquired infections. So immunity level, if patient's immunity level is low, then sometimes nosocomial infection can occur to the patient, which can lead to endocarditis. And then the third thing is the procedure associated. So bacteria, how can enter in our body? Through some procedures also it can invade in our body. So first one is intravascular devices. Intravascular means inside the vessels. Inside the vessels means blood vessels like arteries and veins. So we are doing cannulization in patient, like we are placing the cannula inside the veins. So in that case also, like central venous catheters and all, in that cases also the bacteria can enter in our body. Then the urogenital surgeries. Urogenital surgeries, some obstetric surgeries are also happening. So through that, it can also insert into our body. Then the dental procedures. So main causative agent of endocarditis can enter in our body through any dental procedures, like simple procedures like cleaning and root canal therapy, like that. So previously I have discussed about the risk factors of endocarditis. Now I am gonna tell the causes of endocarditis. So mainly it is an infection, right? So it can cause by some bacteria as well as some viruses also. So now we will look for the causative agents which are causing endocarditis. So first one is the Staphylococcus aureus. So this bacteria we have heard so many times that it can cause different infections in our body. So here it is the main causative factor of endocarditis. And how it is entering in our body? Through IV abuse, as I earlier discussed, that IV drug abuse can be a cause of endocarditis. So IV abuse, and then any kind of skin abscesses, like any mass or any tumors, if they are in skin, then it can also be a place where Staph aureus can placed. Then the prosthesis, CVP line and pacemakers. These are the cardiogenic risk factors, comes under cardiogenic risk factors. So after that, we will go, the next bacteria is Streptococcus species. So Streptococcus is another gram-positive bacteria, and how it is entering in our body? Through the dental procedures like cleaning and then root canal therapy. Through this, it can enter our body, and through blood, it can reach to the heart and then cause the endocarditis. After that, the third one is Enterococcus. So Enterococcus is enter in our body through any kind of UTI. UTI is urinary tract infections. So that it can enter in our body and cause endocarditis. The fourth one is Streptococcus bovis. So this bacteria is mainly a resident of our bowel tract, like the colon, the large intestine, small intestine. There this bacteria are found in our body. So if a person is having colorectal cancer, like cancer of the colon and rectum, and then IBD, inflammatory bowel diseases, in those persons this bacteria is present in their colon, so that can lead to endocarditis. And the fifth one is Cardiobacterium. So this is also a main bacteria which is causing endocarditis. And out of these all causative agents, the Cardiobacterium is the only one which is a gram negative bacteria, and others are the gram-positive bacteria. So if you are seeing how these bacteria are entering into the heart, so if we consider this as a heart valve, okay? So first, there is a formation of NBTE complex. So NBTE, it suggests for non-bacteriothromboemboli. So what is two terms we have to understand? What is thrombus and what is emboli? So if any plaque is forming inside our body, in the blood vessels or heart, that is known as thrombus. Plaque, like there is a plate group of platelet and fibrin. So it is accumulating and it is not moving. This is stationary only, that is known as thrombus. And when this thrombus start to move, that is known as emboli. So this one is a non-bacteriothromboemboli. How it is forming? Due to the platelet and fibrin. Both are present in our blood. They are stucking in the valve side and forming the NBTE complex. Here, one thing we have to remind that there is no bacteria present in this. Then the bacteria are entering in our body through the roots, and then these bacteria stuck here and start to grow. This is known as vegetation of bacteria. Thus, the endocarditis is forming. So next, I will explain the pathophysiology. So pathophysiology means how the disease is developing. So in case of endocarditis, as it is an infectious disease, so first the bacteria enters inside the person's body. Then what it does, it damages the endothelial surface. So the endocardium, the inner lining of the heart, is damaged by the bacteria. Then what happens? Primary focus on infection causative agents. Those agents like the Streptococcus, Staphylococcus, they are entering in the body, they are damaging the inner lining of the heart. After that, what happens? The bacteria, fungi and viruses accumulated and form a vegetation inside the endocardium layer. So formation of vegetation occurs. That vegetation starts moving. So the emboli forms. Then the emboli moves either to the left side of the left side of the heart or the right side of the heart. If it is going to the right side of the heart, it goes to lungs, and if it is moving towards the left side of the heart, it goes to brain, liver and other major organs. So then next stage is either it is diagnosed and managed through the antibiotics and other treatments. If the management is proper, the patient starts healing or recovering from the disease. Or if the condition get more worse, then the valve is completely damaged, which lead to cardiac failure or heart failure. So next I am going to discuss about the clinical manifestations of endocarditis. So there we are grouping the clinical manifestations in some categories. The first one is the early manifestations or early signs. So through early signs we can guess or identify that maybe there is some possibilities of getting endocarditis. The second is the vascular signs. So it is related to cardiovascular system only. So there are some specific signs which are occurring related to the vascular places. So that vascular signs are also there. And the third one is the embolization. So as I told earlier, the emboli start moving in through the blood vessels. So some signs are also specified due to that embolization of the vegetation of bacteria. So first I will go through the early manifestations. So just like other infectious diseases, headache is common in this, then malaise or muscle ache is also happening in this case, then weakness. The patient will feel weaker than the normal person. Then fatigue also can occur. After that, clubbing of fingers. So the fingertips become enlarged, then it is known as the clubbing of fingers. But one thing we have to remember, that clubbing of fingers is seen in the younger adults, not in older adults. After that, weight loss will be there. Due to anorexia, patient will not take the required amount of food, so it can lead to weight loss and weakness also. After that, fever can also seen in this case. So for fever, we have to note the patient's condition clearly, that intermittent fever will be present for 4 to 6 weeks. So these are the some early manifestations which can be found in endocarditis. Next, I will move to the vascular signs. So first one is splinter hemorrhage. As the name suggests, hemorrhage, that means there are leaking of blood from the blood vessels. So where it is found? The black longitudinal lines in the nails. So the patient's nail will have some black longitudinal line will appear in the patient's nails. The second one is petechiae. So where it will happen? In the lips, buccal mucosa and around the mouth. The third one is Osler's sign. So this one, in Osler's sign, what happens? It's also a kind of hemorrhage, and in this it is happening in the fingertips, foot and palm. These three places it is seen. And fourth one is Roth spot. So Roth spot is what? It's also a type of hemorrhage, but it is specifically happening in the retina of the patients. So four vascular signs are there. First one is splinter hemorrhage happening in the nail. It is black longitudinal lines. Second one is petechiae happening in the lips, buccal mucosa and around the mouth cavity. Third one is Osler sign. It is found in the fingertips, foot and palm. And fourth one is the Roth spot. It is the hemorrhagic spots in the retina of the patient. So four vascular signs are mainly seen in endocarditis. Next, I will move to the embolization of the vegetation of bacteria. So if the emboli is going to spleen, what happens? Pain will be feel, then enlargement of the spleen. So pain, where it is feel? In the left part of the stomach. So spleen is situated in the upper left part of the stomach. So one sharp pain will be there, and also tenderness will be there. If we are touching the patient will feel more pain. Then enlargement of spleen. So next is the kidney. If that emboli moving to kidney, what happens? It will lead to hematuria. So hematuria means the patient will have found blood in the urine. So hematuria will be there, and also it can lead to congestive kidney failure. Third one is the limbs. So if the emboli is inserted in the blood vessels of hand or legs, what will happen? It will stop the blood flow which is going to the hands, and it can lead to gangrene also. The last one is brain. If it is moving to brain, then it will stop the blood supply towards the brain, and then it can lead to some visual changes. And brain is controlling all our body parts, so all the body parts will be get affected by this. So there will be visual changes, there will be problem in thinking, the patient will be confused. Without any brain damage, the patient will feel confusion, ataxia, and these are the signs due to the movement of emboli in the brain. So the main three things are here are the early manifestations, the vascular signs, and the embolization. So next I am going to discuss about the types of endocarditis. So endocarditis is mainly classified on two types. So first one is the acute endocarditis, and second one is the subacute endocarditis. As the name suggests, in case of acute, the manifestations will be more prominent, and acute endocarditis is more severe and it can lead to death also. The subacute one is less severe than the acute one, and generally in this some normal signs are shown, and it can be treated by the antibiotics only. So acute endocarditis is mainly caused by the Staphylococcus group of bacteria, while the subacute one is mainly caused by the Streptococcus bacteria groups. So next one is diagnosis. How can we diagnose that the patient is suffering from endocarditis? So just like some other condition, the first priority is health history taking and the physical examination. So at the time of history taking, we generally look if the patient is having any previous history of endocarditis, or if the patient is having any surgery related to the heart valves, or any prosthesis valve is there or not. We will see those things. After that, we will ask the patient if the patient is having fever, malaise, fatigue, because these are the normal signs. Secondly, we will go for the physical examination. So while doing the physical examinations, we will see the vascular sign as well as the signs related to embolization. And thirdly, we will pay our attention while doing the cardiac examination. Like we can find murmuring sound also. So these are the general diagnosis we do in case of endocarditis. After that, we will go for blood culture. So how? There is a specific type of blood culture we are doing in this case. We will take three samples within 1 hour, and out of these three samples, every sample should come positive. So this is the blood culture process for endocarditis. The reports will show that it is elevated ESR rate and elevated CRP rate. So CRP is C-reactive protein, which is elevated in case of endocarditis as the bacteria are present in the blood. So next we will go for the chest X-ray. So through chest X-ray we can see that if any anomaly is formed inside the heart or not. And then the normal ECG and echocardiography we will go for. So these are the common diagnostic procedures we are doing in case of endocarditis patient. So lastly, we are going to discuss about the management of endocarditis. So endocarditis is a disease condition. After diagnosis, we generally go for management. So first of all, we are discussing here the antibiotic therapy, as endocarditis is formed by the bacteria. So main line of drugs will be the antibiotics. So what are the antibiotics we are giving to the patient here? First one is penicillin. It can be a drug of choice. Second one is gentamicin. So these two are mainly provided to the patient of endocarditis. So the regime will be 4 to 6 weeks. We will give this whole therapy course for 4 to 6 week of period. After that, we will again test the blood. Blood culture will again will be done at hospital setup. And if any further bacteria are still present there, then it will provide a long term medications for these two. Second one is the symptomatic management. So there are so many symptoms, right? Like the fever, malaise, fatigue, headache. So for that, management is separate type of management is there. First one is the rest. Rest must be provided to the patient, not complete bed rest, but the patient will be having more rest than a normal being. then the fluid. The patient is having fever. So for fever cases, fluid supplements should be given to the patient properly. Then antipyretic agents. So antipyretics are mainly used for treating the fever. Then aspirins. So aspirins are also provided to this patient because headache is there, fever is there. So these are the symptomatic management for endocarditis. Lastly, we will go for the nursing management. So as a nurse, there are some responsibilities for these patients also. Like first, we have to assess the patient's condition. After that, we have to form the diagnosis, nursing diagnoses, and then we will prepare a nursing care plan for those patients. So generally, these patients can have complaints of the heart failure also, decreased cardiac output also. So first we have to assess the patient's general vital signs, then we have to provide the prescribed medications to the patient, and then we should assure the patient is having proper rest, proper food, and the fluid is balanced completely. Thus the patients can be treated, and if the management is proper, then the patient can get recover within the 4 to 6 week of period. If it is not treatable, then it can lead to valve damage, which may lead to death also. So in this class, we have seen about endocarditis, like what is endocarditis, how it is forming, the pathophysiology of endocarditis, the main clinical manifestations like the signs and symptoms of endocarditis. Then we have seen that how we can diagnose the disease condition. After that, what are the management we can provide to the patient. I hope this lecture is understandable by you all. And please let us know if it is clear or not. If any queries are there, then also let us know. Thank you.